In this two-part series, we're going to explore how we can use Midjourney images along with Boris Effects Continuum and Sapphire. In the first part, we're going to look at how we can use this abstractly. We're going to take images such as blurred out backgrounds, not to mention grunge textures, and feed this to certain filters within our package. Let's get started with part one. Okay, I'm here inside of After Effects. I would like to add Sapphire's S lens flare to this video clip. I'll stop here, and then from the Sapphire lighting category, apply it to the clip, and then I'll drag the lens flare's position to match that of the sun, and then its pivot point, I'll just lower it here in the frame. Let's start off by choosing a preset. I'll load a preset, and since we're searching for something sun-like, I'll do a search over here on the right. Let me click through a few of these. And I like this Palm Beach sunrise, which I'll also mark as a favorite for future use, and load this inside of After Effects. Now, what's really unique about Sapphire's lens flares is that you can access the individual components when you edit the lens. And a component available to you happens to be lens dirt. I'm going to hop inside of the effect controls and edit this lens. And draw your attention here to the left-hand side where we can add other components as well as start from other presets. In this case, I'll click here where it says new and just choose components. And I want to do a search for dirt. And you have these four dirt elements. Let's click to add this dirt element. And I want to draw your attention to the components of the lens flare preset that we chose. We could select one of these and make changes to it. But specifically with the lens dirt, you'll notice at the bottom of the parameters here, a texture overlay, and we can choose to load our own. What I'd like to do is get Midjourney to create this texture overlay and then feed it into Sapphire. So let's start somewhere. I'll head to Discord, and it just so happens that I've tried several prompts in terms of getting some bokeh, a dirt background, to no success. In this instance, I would then rely on an image for Midjourney to describe and then utilize the text prompt recommendations that it gave me. In order to do this, we're going to use the describe feature. So one site that I go to is unsplash.com. And here you could do a search for bokeh or lens dirt texture. And anything that doesn't have Unsplash Plus on it is free to use. And you can simply download that. If you're using another site, it's really important to check the copyright and make sure there's no restrictions with using it with Gen AI tools. I already have a texture on my system that I would like to use. So I'm going to head back to Discord and then type /describe. If I hit the tab key, it's going to ask me to now upload an image. So I'll click here. And I just so happen to have this blue bokeh ready. So I'm going to open this. I'm going to head back to the text field and press return to see some text prompts that Midjourney recommends. So I've got four to choose from. So blue light's bright in the style of overexposure, not to mention the name of a person, along with a celebration of nature. And this idea of glowing lights, noise photography, etc., seems to be a theme with all of these prompts. Let's try Midjourney's first recommendation. I'm going to press one. And because I have remix enabled, I'm going to make a change here. Blue lights are bright on a black background. And I'll keep the next couple lines of the effect, but I won't mention this part here or joyful celebration of nature. So I'm going to remove that text from the prompt and then change the aspect ratio here, --AR to 16:9. Let's submit that job and wait to see what Midjourney comes up with. While we can see examples 1 and 3 are bokeh mixed with a person, we're getting something more along the lines of what we're looking for with 2 and 4. I'm going to select V2 and get a couple variations, and in this case, actually get rid of the word luminous shadowing, see if that helps the creation a bit with the remix. Also, keep in mind that there's no harm in trying one of those other text prompt recommendations, or alternatively, using that photo in an image-based prompt for it to create new pieces of work. Okay, great. I can see U3 being used as an element, so I'm going to click on the U3 badge to up-res this, and then from Midjourney, right-click this to save this image to my downloads folder. Now heading back to the Flare Designer, here's that lens dirt element that we selected from components. And under texture overlay in properties, I will load from my downloads that textured bokeh element. And we can see it here clearly. Now the cool thing is we have all of these properties here that we can play with. One of those is the overall brightness of the texture. If we want to make that more subtle, can also move around the lens flare on the screen to see the variation. Alternatively too, you have an offset off axis, which will change where the bokeh bright spots show up. In this case, I'll press OK. And now that's loaded here inside of After Effects. Now, use case number two comes inside of Continuum's BCC plus light. If you're unfamiliar with light, here I am in a new composition. I'll do a search here for BCC plus, followed by light. You're gonna find this in the lights category. I'm gonna apply this to the clip. We'll see a gobo slash light modifier appear on the screen. The cool part is, if you go to the effects editor, is there are hundreds of presets to choose from. The fact is that these are all 1000 by 1000 pixel images, and several of these, especially ones in the new category, happen to be seamless. And this is where we can use Midjourney's tile feature. So I'll type in the prompt /imagine prompt. I'm going to type in blinds and shadows, followed by the comma --tile. I'll hit return and let Midjourney do its work. Okay, here we have some textured elements. I happen to like the first one, so I'll click on U1. And it's a really good idea before bringing it into After Effects to make sure that it is actually seamless. Every once in a while, there might be a problem with the way these images are created. So I'll right-click this and save this image to my downloads. And I'm here on a site where we can check this seamless texture. One thing we could do is just click on the File button and navigate to where that tile is saved and upload it. You'll see here, this is how it looks, and we can check it by simply dragging on the scroll to make sure that it's seamless all the way across. Now inside of After Effects, we're gonna bring this texture into our project, and I'm gonna bring it inside my composition. I'll select the layer that has light on it, and in order to have it be seamless in this example, all we have to do is change it from gobo to input, and then select the layer that we'd like to use as the input. We can see that it sees it here. And if we go just a little bit lower, you'll see that you have an option for different edge modes. I've now switched this to wrap. And in order to see the seamless tiles, inside of both Premiere Pro and After Effects, it's either going to be reading your composition settings or your sequence settings and the dimensions. So if we scale down under the transform settings, the actual tile will be able to see these seamless textures, and then use corner pinning or other transform properties to perfect the way that this looks. Here's a full screen example that I accomplished by adjusting these settings. Next up is Sapphire's Infinite Zoom, and this allows you to create a zoom on an alpha-based source that keeps on going and going with rotation animation also added to the mix. Now, when we want to think about creating an element for this inside of Midjourney, we want to create a simple element that can be duplicated and zoomed in over and over again. For this infinite zoom, I wasn't sure what I wanted, so I set up with a /imagine prompt and set up a permutation. If you're unfamiliar with permutations, this is a really powerful text prompt where you can put certain words in brackets, and the words in brackets are going to allow you to create multiple jobs from it. So here with my imagine prompt, I'm going to type in a single, and now in curly brackets, which is the permutation, I'll say powerful, comma, bright, comma, elegant. I will close with a squiggly bracket, type in the word particle on another squiggly bracket here, black, comma, dark, close squiggly bracket, background. So with this prompt, after I enter the aspect ratio here, AR69, this is going to create 6 jobs of 4 photos each. So if I press return, as we can see, it's going to create multiple prompts from this template. I'm going to press yes, and let's see it get to work. So right now it's going to create 6 jobs based on this text prompt. One, a single powerful particle on a black background. a single bright particle on a black background, followed by elegant, and then all of those three also on a dark background. The best part is we can see each of these jobs of four and choose which one we like the best. Okay, my six jobs are finished here with the first prompt, a single bright particle on a black background. I really like number three. And I'm looking for some examples here which have black on the edges. Could try to define that with the text prompt. This one here, a single bright particle on a dark background, U3 also works. This could work too if we darken the background. And in fact, this U3 one also works here. So in fact, I could actually download a few of these to test out with infinite zoom, but I'll show this example using it from my first text prompt. Let's save that image onto the system. And inside of After Effects, I'm going to load that image and I'm going to place it into a new composition. Once I do, I'll then place infinite zoom on it, but we have a little bit of work to do. We don't want to see the edges of the image, so we're going to add a mask around it. In order to do that in Effect Controls, I'll turn off infinite zoom. And with this layer selected, just double click to apply the ellipse mask. In order to see that, let me just head over here to my composition view options and turn on my layer controls. I'll click off the mask for a second in order to drag in the individual points so it's just not right on the edges. And with the layer selected, press F and feather this by about 50. Now I'll turn back on infinite zoom and let's, for a second, turn off the spiral strand so we'll have no spiral. So we can see the image. And if I drag the zoom value, how this is constantly zooming in to the result. Now, in order for it to see the mask correctly, we need to go to the mask path and choose mask one in order for it to see it correctly. I'll now click off. The mask feather is a bit noticeable, so I'll actually drag it in even more. And now let's start with the infinite zoom process. I'll option click zoom to add a time-based expression. And it doesn't have to be very long, so I'm going to type in time times two. Generally, in Sapphire, small numbers go a very long way. And let's just play, and let me just play back this infinite zoom that we have so far. I'm going to trim this comp to 10 seconds and actually add a twist to it as well. I'll option click the twist value and type in time times 0.1. And now we have this image with an infinite zoom with a twist. In order to perfect this even more, feel free to play with the zoom center of where we're zooming into. I'll play with this a bit more so we can see that bright spot a bit clearer, followed by the shrink level. So here we can see a twisting zooming animation of our created particle in Midjourney. To show a couple examples of this, I also did a square-based result here. This prompt was just simply a single particle, and this was one of the creations in square on a black background. I masked this out as well and added a few additional Sapphire effects, including Ultra Glow and Emboss, in order to create a 3D feel. If I press U, you can see that both Zoom and Twist have been animated. Now let's move on to our final example, which is working with BCC Grunge. I have an After Effects solid here in my comp, and I'm just going to do a search for BCC Grunge in this instance, which you'll find in the Stylized category, and I'll apply it to the solid. And there are two ways to work with Grunge with presets. One is that we could choose from a series of textures with built-in effects. That's what you would do up here. In fact, I'm going to reset this. The other is just to choose a base texture itself. The best part is that this texture section is available to you. And you can throw in your own JPEGs in it. Automatically, Grunge will see it. And then you could work with other effects to build your background. So in this case, I'll head to Midjourney and just do a simple imagine prompt of a grunge, dirty texture background. Follow that with a comma and do AR16.9. Midjourney will get to work. And I can see all of these could work as a nice grunge-based texture. In fact, I'm going to stick with U1 in this case. Let's enlarge that. And I'm going to right-click and save this image. Just a note that Midjourney actually gives you a PNG image. We're going to need to convert it to a JPEG. And here inside Preview, choose to export this at the highest quality JPEG possible, which I'll save out. Now, in order for Grunge to see this, we need to place this in a specific folder. First of all, we can see, so here's my JPEG image. and I'm going to place it in this grunge texture folder. To show you the file path, I'll select it here on my sidebar. On a Mac, this happens to be in your library, application support, Boris effects, grunge texture. In a PC, you'll see it listed below. So in order to see this texture, we're going to need to close and open After Effects. You also want to keep in mind the name of the texture because it's based on alphabetical order. Okay, I've closed and opened After Effects again. And here in Effect Controls of Grunge, I'm just going to click on this list and there's my texture, the one that I loaded. And as mentioned, in alphabetical order compared to the ones that ship with it. Now, you can mix this with colorizing it, using a displacement map, adding flicker, and the list goes on at all of these options to make this texture your own for a background or foreground element. And those are a few different ways that you can use Midjourney with both Continuum and Sapphire. Join me for part two. We're going to explore the Midjourney zoom feature and how we can add auto-animating effects to our animation. For more tips and tricks just like this, don't forget to like and subscribe here at borisfx.com.